Fast lectures?
Worse.
Well, not fast, okay. Well, so in the evening, of course, there will still be lectures and functions and so on. So, convolutions, right? Topless matrices and circles, very popular nowadays. And, yeah, basically, to talk about convolution, we have to mention the code. I don't see what it's shown there. So, who's the guru of convolutions? Yeah, that's the citation from the Bortian interpretation, right? And there is the answer from the Kirill Yandikov. I don't know if you can see it. So it says, well, the first part says, well, the elementary operations on numbers are simply special cases of one times one convolutions. That's what people take. So, okay, then there's a joke after that. The answer of Likud is that this is more right than you think. A multiplication is a convolution of one multi-digit number by another one over the digit dimension. Okay, who understands why it is so? Why multiplication of numbers is a convolution over the digit dimension? No one. Okay. As the guru says, think about it. That's really a convolution over the digit dimension. So it's not so stupid. You know, I think multiplication of integers is the convolution. No? Okay, whatever. Yeah, if you multiply very long, for example, binary digits, this is a convolution. But we are in numerical linear algebra course, so we're interested mostly in solving linear systems, completely independent problems. So far we only talked about sparse matrices, but actually the iterative method, they work well for any matrix that have this black box matrix for a product, and the quantum class, the topless matrices, as well, chemical matrices, and also the multi-level variance. And they're directly related to two things. They are directly related, these matrices are directly related to the so-called convolution operation, and fast Fourier transform. So what's convolution that you probably have seen? So you have two one-dimensional signals, continuous, and the convolution of these two signals, so they are defined on an infinite line. The convolution is just this product of shifted versions of this. So you take a sort of correlation between the signal and the signal shifted by t. So another way of looking at this would be that x of t is a filter that is applied to our signal. X of t is a filter, or no, or some of them is a filter, probably both of them can be, this is a symmetric form. So this is a, if you restrict, for example, x to be a certain window, this is a, in discrete case, you take the value from the left, value from the right, the value from the middle, and you mix them. That would be the value in the convolution. So it's all filtering operations and all signaling processing operations that have the shift invariance property. If you consider the operation here and here, they are the same. They are all related to convolutions. And again, that's what is taught, not in the school, unfortunately, but in the first years of the university, is the convolution theorem. So the convolution is defined as an integral operator in the time domain. So this is an integral, non-local transform between two signals in the time domain. But if you go into the frequency domain, so you take a Fourier transform, which is defined as follows, take a Fourier transform, then the convolution becomes element-wise multiplication. So the Fourier transform of the convolution, which is defined as an infinite integral, that's very important, that it's an infinite integral, integral over the infinite range is the product of the Fourier transform. So then that's the algorithm. This is not the algorithm how you do it in the discrete case. But on the continuous, so we just want to have two signals, compute Fourier transform of each signal, take element wise, and then you have to go back from the frequency domain to the time domain and do it using inverse Fourier transform. That's sort of the algorithm. But again, we never deal with infinite signals, so each signal they have their certain range, and then there are problems with the boundary. You can either put zero on the boundary, you can put periodic condition on the boundary, and so on. And this only works in the discrete case, you always have to deal with this finite representation of the signal. So, what can I say about discrete convolution? So how I get discrete convolution from the continuous convolution? Easily. So take the integral, we say, okay, properly our signal lives only on some interval. So it's zero outside some interval, maybe it's periodic. Then you can replace integral over the, by the interval of the integration. But assume it's some finite. And then we approximate the integral just by what is called quadrature sum. So we approximate the integral just by sum of the values at some points. And this is the summation that we are left with. So sum again is products of x and j, which is shifted by some number. And this is what is called discrete convolution. Again, if you have the, then you can say that xj is a filter coefficient which you apply to x. So that's the discrete convolution. The whole goal of the fast delta is to compute this discrete convolution in a nicer way. And first, what we do, we rewrite this convolution as a matrix by vector product. So this is actually a matrix by vector product. If we introduce a new matrix, which is n times n, and the element in the position ij of this matrix is just y I minus j. So the element of the matrix depends only on the difference between row index and column index. And this matrix has a special name. So this matrix is called Toeplitz matrix. So the matrix is called Toeplitz if its elements are the same. If you look at this matrix, you can immediately see that it is Toeplitz because it should have the same entries on each of the diagonals. Take the main diagonal, A0. You take the first diagonal, A1. You take the first super diagonal, A minus 1, and so on. So, how many? This is obviously a structured matrix because to, in order to store this matrix in memory, you do not have to store the full matrix and stuff. That would be completely stupid because all of the elements, most of the elements are equal. So, you only have to store the first column and the first row. These two vectors have one element in the intersection, so you have to store 2n minus 1 parameters. It is not sparse. It's, well, it can be sparse if you have only a few numbers to assume a that will have this bandwidth. So in this case, it will be also sparse, but the general case is just this structured matrix defined by n parameters. So, and the main operation that we need is the discrete convolution, and discrete convolution is the product of a given Toeplitz matrix times vector. N squared is the dense case. How we can multiply such matrix by vector in N squared case? N squared operations. Okay. So we need to make a bridge from Toeplitz matrices back to our nice convolution theorem. Fourier transform, element wise product Fourier transform. And this bridge is done using a special subclass of Toeplitz matrices, which are called circular matrices. So, what is a circular matrix? A circular matrix is a Toeplitz matrix which has sort of periodicity structure. So better to illustrate by example, consider this 4 times 4 matrix. So, you have C0 here, it's okay. Then you have C3 goes here, and then it pops up out here. C2 goes here, pops out here, and so on. So each diagonal is periodic. So this is a circle. This is a circle matrix, and it corresponds to the so-called periodic convolution. So if you take the signal that is periodic, then the corresponding discretization of convolution will be exactly multiplication of circular matrix directly. So you have a circular matrix of a fixed size, well, in this case 4, they have wonderful properties that all these matrices, they have the same eigenvectors. So we have been talking in the previous lectures about how we compute the eigenvectors, and I was saying that it is not possible to compute all the eigenvectors, solve the partial, the full eigenvalue problems, faster than qubits, except for very special cases. This is one of the very few examples where you can solve the eigenvalue problem because we exactly know how the eigenvectors look like. So these matrices, they have the same set of eigenvectors which are given by the codes or by the so-called discrete Fourier transform matrix. This is sort of good luck. And the main theorem is so-called spectral theorem. So how it's formally defined, and that's the key point here, is that any circular matrix can be represented as a product of F star lambda F, where F is the Fourier matrix. So even if the elements of C, they are real, the eigenvectors will have complex elements. So this is the nth root of, if the matrix becomes n, this is the nth root of 1, formally defined here. So with, in this definition, we don't add any normalization to the matrix F. So F is a square matrix with these elements. Its columns are orthogonal, but they're not orthonormal. So if, for example, if you take the column corresponding to k equal to 0, you have all ones, so the norm will be equal to square root of n. So in order to make this matrix a unitary matrix, you need to multiply by 1 over square root of n. So another interpretation would be define a Fourier matrix with scaling factor. Then we'll have C equals a unitary matrix times the angular matrix times the unitary matrix, which is exactly eigen decomposition. So circular matrices, from this we actually see the circular matrices are normal matrices because they are diagonalized by a unitary matrix. And moreover, it's very easy to find what are the eigenvalues. So the eigenvalues of the circular matrix are just Fourier transform and normalized applied to the first column of the circle. So Joplin's matrix is defined by 2n minus 1 parameters, but the Joplin's circular matrix is uniquely defined by the first column, and the first row is just reshuffled in the opposite way, first column. So that's basically it. In fact, we can stop the lecture here, that's the most important part, but let's go on. Yeah.
I didn't mention at the beginning of the lecture Joplin's matrices now works only with circular ones. What's the relation to the circular?
Yeah, that's the main point, because discrete convolution corresponds to the multiplication of a Joplin's matrix directly. Circle is a special class of Joplin's matrices. The next question is how to multiply Joplin's matrix by vector if you know how to multiply circular matrix by vector. Joplin's matrices, they do not have this representation. If you have aperiodic convolution, it is not possible to then diagonalize it by Fourier transform. So, and this is only for a special class of Joplin's matrices where you have this nice result, and we will use this theorem later to show how to compute discrete convolution. But before, let's look at the Fourier matrix, one of the most important matrices, numerical analysis, signal processing, and so on. That's how it looks like, just this. And it's not Hermitian, it's symmetric, it is unitary. But what is most important is that we can multiply this matrix by a vector with n log n complexity. Cannot get it from the small n, But basically, this is a dense matrix multiplied by vector takes n squared by a naive algorithm, but you can use fast Fourier transform to have n log n. So this is the key to many efficient signal processing algorithms, so we can compute the exactly in n log n directions. And yeah, so you can use to compute basically the spectrum. That's the initial signal. And so what we do here in this example? So we just take the sum of sinusoids. So this is a signal that is the sum of sinusoid with high oscillations. So that's how it looks in the time domain. And if you just go and take the just FFT plus some reshuffling of the answer.